In this video, we will see blood supply and nerve supply of kidney. Let's start with blood supply first. As you must be knowing, heart pumps blood into the aorta. Renal artery arises from the abdominal aorta. Upon entering the kidney, it divides into segmental arteries. The segmental arteries then divide into lobar arteries. Usually there is one lobar artery for each pyramid. Lobar arteries further divide into interlobar arteries which run in between the pyramids. Then they divide into arcuate arteries which run along the base of the pyramid. They give origin to interlobular arteries which go towards the periphery. Afferent arterioles arise from the interlobular arteries. They enter into the renal corpuscle of respective nephrons. Close to corpuscle, they have specialized cells called granular cells. They are part of chesta glomerular apparatus. The arteriole then forms the glomerular capillary tuft which continues as efferent arteriole. You might have noticed the diameter of the efferent arteriole is smaller than the diameter of afferent arteriole. This is to maintain pressure inside the glomerulus for filtration. Efferent arterioles again divide to form a second capillary network. The capillary network arising from efferent arterioles of cortical nephrons is different from that of juxtamedullary nephrons. These are the cortical nephrons. Their efferent arterioles form the peritubular capillary network in the cortex. This network supplies the portion of tubules that lie in the cortex. These are the juxtamedullary nephrons. Their efferent arterioles descend into the medulla, form a hairpin-shaped loop, and come back to the cortex. It is called vasa recta. The portion going deeper is called descending vasa recta, and portion coming out is called ascending vasa recta. It supplies portion of tubules that lie in the medulla. Out of total blood coming into the kidney, about 90% perfuses cortical nephrons and cortex, and only 10% perfuses juxtamedullary nephrons and medulla. This low blood supply to medulla helps in maintaining medullary hyperosmolarity. Venous drainage is same for both the capillary networks. Both the capillaries drain into interlobular vein. Interlobular vein drain into arcuate vein. Then comes interlobar vein, lobar vein, segmental vein, and renal vein, all running parallel to the respective arteries. Renal vein drains into inferior vena cava, which finally empties into the heart. This was the blood supply to kidney. Organization of blood vessels and nephrons can be easily understood if you know how urine is formed. So let's see it briefly in a hypothetical model of simplified kidney. It has an artery that enters into the renal corpuscle. Blood is filtered here. Filtrate moves ahead in the tubule and remaining blood moves towards the vein. Filtrate is then further processed along the tubule. Final urine comes out via ureter and purified blood via vein. To be more realistic, same process is done by multiple nephrons. Renal artery eventually divides into million branches to supply all the nephrons. Urine from all the nephrons is collected at one place and comes out by a single channel. Similarly, all the veins also unite and single renal vein leaves kidney. Now nerve supply. Kidneys receive only sympathetic nerves. There is no parasympathetic innervation. Sympathetic fibers come from thoracolumbar outflow. From there, they pass through various plexuses and ganglia and form renal plexus near renal artery. Finally, fibers from renal plexus innervate kidney. These fibers run along the arteries. They innervate arteries including afferent and efferent arterioles, granular cells of afferent arteriole, and tubular epithelial cells. Fibers supplying blood vessels regulate renal blood flow and glomerular filtration rate. Those supplying granular cells regulate renin release. And fibers supplying tubular epithelium regulate the rate of sodium reabsorption. So that was the nerve supply. That's it for this video. In next video, we will see juxtaglomerular apparatus. Thank you.